إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل دلالة في النار. وبعد. All praise is due to Allah. We laud Him, beseech Himself, and in Him we seek forgiveness. And we seek the refuge of Allah from the mischiefness of our souls and the wrongdoings of all of our actions. Whoever Allah guides, no one can lead him astray. And whoever Allah leaves to be left astray, no one can guide him. And I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah. He's alone and He has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is His abd and His rasul. As to what follows, surely the best speech is the book of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of the sunnah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And the worst of all affairs are newly invented matters. For every newly invented matter is an innovation. Every innovation is astray, and every astray is in the hellfire. Last week, brothers and sisters in Islam, we were talking about this heinous sin of al-ghiba, of backbiting, and al-buht, slander, and an-namima, carrying tales to spread fitna among the Muslims. We'd like to continue on this Jum'ah, inshallah ta'ala, on this particular subject, of which all of us should be trying our best to stay away from. As the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. That would have forbidden for you, stay away from, far, far away from it. Some of the causes for al-ghiba and al-buhd, backbiting and slander, are not known to the common Muslim. Shaitan, or our nafs, whispers to us and causes us and incites us. He prods us, na'udhu billahi minhu, and we seek refuge with Allah from him. He prods and throws the darts of enmity and hatred into our hearts and makes us fall into this dangerous, heinous, abominable sin of backbiting and slander. To this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And hasten to the forgiveness from your Lord and a garden, or Jannah. A Jannah, the extensiveness of it, the wideness of this Jannah, of which is the distance of the heavens, farther than the heavens and the earth. And it is prepared for those who have taqwa. الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ. Those who spend benevolently and the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ease as well as in hardship, and those who restrain their anger. وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And those who pardon men. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who do good. In this particular ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining to us that He loves those of the muhsinun. And He explains to us about those individuals who are the muttaqun, those who fear Allah. And one of the descriptions of them are those who restrain their anger. And one of the causes of backbiting is that when an individual becomes angry, he wants to vent his anger and his frustration on someone, he'll talk about them in a bad light. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises those in this ayah, those who control their anger And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are able to control our anger and not vent our anger and our frustrations against someone, causing ourselves to backbite them. To this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he said in the collection of a Tabarani's hadith, the hadith that is collected or narrated by Mu'adh ibn Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, من كظم غيظا وهو قادر على أن ينفذه دعاه الله على رؤوس الخلائق حتى يخيره من الحور العين يزوجه منها ما شاء. الله أكبر. The Messenger of Allah عليه الصلاة والسلام said, whoever represses or restrains his anger and he is able to carry it out, من كظم الغيظ وهو قادر على أن ينفذه, whoever controls his anger when he has the ability to vent it, whoever controls his anger when he has the ability to let it loose, دعا الله على رؤوس الخلائق, Allah will call him before all the creation to make him choose from among the حور العين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call him in front of all of the creation and allow him to have those wide-eyed, voluptuous women that are waiting for the men in Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Just for controlling your anger when you had the ability to let it loose. And for the women who are wondering what they're going to get their husbands, inshallah. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يُزَوِّجُهُ مِنْهَا مَا شَاءَ, and marry him to any one of them that he, the person, chooses. The person who restrained their anger when they had the ability to let it loose, Allah will not just give him a حُورُ الْعَيْنِ, He'll allow him to choose any one of them that he wants. SubhanAllah. One of the other causes of backbiting, which is this heinous sin that we want for all of us to pay close attention to, is compromising and supporting one's friends. Sometimes we fall into camps and groups, and if an individual did something to another individual and he doesn't like it, or if an individual backbit someone or slandered someone or did some type of haram in front of someone's presence, then that person may enjoin in the good and forbidding the evil by correcting that individual in their face. Then that individual becomes shy or ashamed because of what they did, because the group of individuals started opposing them. So as a means to not fall into the bad graces of that individual or to get on the you-know-what list with those individuals, that person will support the individual in their wrong. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already told us, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ, help one another in righteousness and piety, and do not help one another in sin and transgression. We cannot fall, we should not fall into the sin of backbiting, brothers and sisters, just to please someone who's standing in front of you because you're afraid of that person. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من أرض الناس بسخط الله وكله الله إلى الناس ومن أسخط الناس برضا الله مؤننة الناس. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, he who seeks the pleasure of the people by the displeasure of Allah, those who seek to please the human beings at the displeasure of Allah, making Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala displeased, trying to please somebody of the creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will entrust him to them. Those individuals who you try to please and you are displeasing Allah, Allah will leave those people to be a trust for you on the day of resurrection. And whoever seeks the pleasure of Allah by the displeasure of the people, Allah will suffice him of the need of the people. And another narration, whoever tries to please the people at the displeasure of Allah, Allah will make them be entrusted to him. And whoever tries to please Allah at the displeasure of the people, Allah will cause the people to be pleased with him and he will be pleased with them. Anytime you find yourself, as an added note, you go to see about a job and the woman who's the supervisor sticks out her hand to shake her hand, to shake your hand, refuse a hand, brothers. And you women who are forced to work, likewise. When the man sticks his hand out to shake your hand, you should not shake his hand fearing that Allah won't be able to provide for you. Make that person displeased, and Allah will be pleased with you, and make the people be pleased with you. Another cause of backbiting among the Muslimun is elevating one person's position by criticizing another person. Some people, which we call dry snitching. Those of you who have been in prison, you know what I'm talking about. They call this dry snitching. You talk about somebody else in a good light and debase another person by way of lifting up that other person. This is backbiting, brothers and sisters in Islam. Even though you didn't directly talk about this individual, you raise this position of this person, and in the light of the other person, you have debased them. This is backbiting, and we should stay far away from it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam giving us an example of another form of backbiting, of those individuals who use backbiting as a tool or as a joke, telling jokes on people even though they're not true. And some people go to the point where they get paid for this. Stand in front of the people and tell lies on people, backbite and slander people just to make money. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَيْلُ لِلَّذِي يُحَدِّثُ فَيَكْذِبْ لِيَضْحَكَ بِهِ الْقَوْمُ وَيْلٌ لَهُ وَيْلٌ لَهُ. He said, woe to the one who lies when he talks to the people to make him laugh through backbiting. Woe to him, woe to him. And another example or reason why people backbite is envy. Envy, jealousy. Backbiting someone because you wish that they didn't have what Allah gave them. Or you wish that they would lose what Allah gave them, and you wish that He would give it to you, so you backbite that person due to the jealousy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to keep out of your hearts, and shaitan is trying to induce you with and prod you to be a part of. Another example of the causes of backbiting is to prove one's innocence from what was attributed to him by relating the accusation to the guilty person, thinking that this is the correct way to do it. Or to mention someone else as a conspirator in the action that was a wrongdoing, and then they say, he also did this, or she also did that. All of these are forms of backbiting. And also, the person who may not have nothing to do with it at all, or the person who was close to the person who did it, you make them a party in that by backbiting that individual also. Or sometimes we don't mention the person's name, but we say he's that real tall brother who weighs 260 pounds and has those black sneakers and the green car. You didn't say his name, but everybody knows who the brother is that's that tall with that much weight, with that color sneakers and car. You think you're getting slick and saying you're not backbiting, but everybody knows who you're talking about. All of this is backbiting, brothers and sisters in Islam, and we should stay far away from it. Another way is to be angry at somebody for the sake of Allah because of some wrong that he's committed, but angrily, in your good intention, you declare that wrong and then you mention the person's name while his name should be concealed, or her name should be concealed of what they were doing, so that you can avoid the backbiting. And also, out of a good intention, shaitan will cause you, out of a good niyyah, out of a pure niyyah in your heart, because of your grief or sorrow for a person, because of something that has happened to him, so you express your feelings that was done wrongly to that individual, and you say out of your love for that individual and your grief and your sorrow for that individual that so and so did this to so and so, or this was done to so and so, and then you backbit that individual who did it. And the Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. And every atom of good you do, you shall see the like of it. And every atom of evil, or atom's weight of evil you do, you shall see the like of it also. وَالْحَمْدُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. الْحَمْدُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. وَالصُّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَى رَسُولِهِ الْكَرِيمِ. سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وبعد. Another cause of backbiting, brothers and sisters in Islam, is using backbiting as a way to fill the emptiness that an individual has and to remove boredom. Some people, they get bored, they don't have anything to do, so they just start making up things, either true or untrue about an individual, just because they don't have anything else to do. The treatment for this, brothers and sisters in Islam, is to spend our time in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and increasing our ibadah, increasing our worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's prophet said, لا تزالوا قدم ابن آدم يوم القيامة من عند ربه حتى يقال عن خمس. That the feet of the son of Adam, all of us, the children of Adam, will not be removed from the possession of his Lord on the day of judgment until he will be asked about five things. عن عمره فيما أثناه. How did he spend his life? Did you spend your life backbiting people? If you add up all the times you backbit in the past 10 years, some of us, unfortunately, will probably come up with a whole year total of backbiting. Think about this, brothers. Think about this, brothers and sisters. How did you spend your life? You spent your life backbiting. And then the next of the five, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَعَنْ شَبَابِهِ فِيمَ أَبْلَاهُ. And how did he spend his youth? Some of you children, some of you youth that are right now talking, leaning back there chewing that gum. Some of you talk about each other and you don't care. You backbite, you slander. Allah is going to ask you, how did you spend your youth? Did you spend your youth while the imam was giving the khutbah, chewing gum, leaning up against the wall, sleeping, playing games? Or did you spend your youth trying to learn about this deen so you can become a productive adult? And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَعَنْ مَالِهِ مِنْ أَيْنَ اكْتَسَبَهُ. From where did he earn his money? Did he earn his money in the haram way? Or did he earn his money in the halal way? Did she earn her money by backbiting people to get her earnings from her earnings? Or did she use her livelihood in a halal way? Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, after saying, and where he earned his money, and how فِيمَ أَنْفَقَهُ, how he spent it, and lastly, وَمَاذَا عَمَلَ فِيمَا عَلِمَ, and how did he use the knowledge that he learned. The knowledge that he or she learned, how did they use it? How did they implement it? All of these things, brothers and sisters, are things that we need to take notice of. We need to pay close attention to these things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger has told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and try to stay far away from this heinous sin. And lastly, but definitely not least, getting close to a person's employer. Getting close to your employer by degrading other employees in order to get promoted or to get a better position. So you backbite the other individual because you know he's up for the job too. So you talk about that individual in a bad light so that the person can look at you and elevate you or promote you to the next position. All of this is haram, brothers and sisters in Islam. And Allah knows best. Allah only knows best, and I don't. If backbiting is haram to the kuffar too, only Allah knows, and I don't. If backbiting is haram on the kuffar too, and this doesn't mean that you can't call them a kafir, because if they're a kafir, they're a kafir. But as far as backbiting, only Allah knows if this pertains to the kuffar too. As for those cases in which it is permissible, as the scholars of Islam say, الذَمُّ لَيْسَ بِغِيبَةٍ فِي سِتَّةٍ, that censorship is not backbiting in six things. These are the times in which a person says something bad about a person behind their back, and it's mashru'. It's legal. Listen to them very closely, brothers and sisters. And all of these things have to be accompanied with a good, pure, unadulterated intention. You just can't say that I'm doing this with a bad intention. The first is a report for the redress of some injustice or some wrong or some tyranny or some high-handedness. In such case, an oppressed person can petition the king or the Qadi, or the Imam, or the Sheikh, or somebody in authority against a person who has perpetrated such tyranny. Secondly, to seek some help to stop some practice or work which may be against the principles of the deen of Islam. Thirdly, to seek a fatwa or a ruling on some specific topic from a qualified person in authority. Fourthly, to caution the Muslims from the evil consequences of some mischief. Fifthly, if somebody indulges in evil practices openly, as for example, zina, or drinking openly of liquor, or using some type of khamr like crack or reefer, or bad treatment of people, or cheating people in their jobs, or usurpation of their property, or imposition and collection of taxes with cruelty, then a person can come with this, which would normally be backbiting, and it would be praiseworthy. And lastly, to introduce somebody when such a person is already known with such nicknames like lame, deaf, blind, squint-eyed, etc. If someone is already known by that, then it's okay. In this particular case, his introduction will be halal. But to use such a word in order to humiliate someone is haram, according to the scholars of Islam, if he can be introduced in another manner. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we should stay far, far away from backbiting and slander, and far away from namima. The Prophet ﷺ said, "La yadkhulu al-janna an-nammam." The person who spreads namima, tales to cause fitna among the Muslims, will not enter paradise. Just because you're not backbiting, just because you're not slandering, it doesn't mean that you'll be admitted into Jannah if you carry tales. Some of us hear things in private and we go outside where those things should have been held inside and the secrecy and the privacy of where it was mentioned. We go out with the pure, with the clean, with the intention of spreading fitna among the people when that story could have been incarcerated, could have been held at bay. But rather we go out, namam, and spread these things among the Muslims to cause fitna and dissension and rancor and hatred. Allah's Prophet ﷺ said, "La yadkhulu al-jannah an-nammam." The nammam will not enter Jannah. The person who takes some information that was said privately, he goes out and he spreads these things to cause fitna and dissension. We should stay far away from these things, brothers and sisters, as we said last week and in the past. The thing that needs to be incarcerated the most is our tongues. We should try with all our level best to keep our tongues purified. When you find yourself getting ready to talk about somebody bad, remember the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam: "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawmil akhir falyaqul khayran aw liyasmut." Whoever believes in Allah on the last day, let him speak good or keep silent. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those individuals who are able to keep our tongues purified from backbiting. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who keep our tongues pure from slander. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep our tongues pure from an-namima. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who enjoin in the good and forbidden the evil when injustice is being done, when tyranny is being done, that we don't use those other principles, but we use the principles of speaking out against a wrong, even against a tyrannical imam, no matter who it is. That we speak out, and Allah fill our hearts with the courage to speak out and stop a wrong when we see it with our hands, and then if we're not able, with our tongues, and if not that, then to hate it in our hearts, which is the weakest of imams. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا. ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به. واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا. أنت مولانا فانصرنا على قوم الكافرين. Before we end this khutbah, brothers and sisters in Islam, I'd like to make a reminder of what we said the other night after the class, more specifically to the women. Some of you women have been coming to classes and coming to Jumu'ah, and you have these conversations among yourselves, and you're disturbing people, and you're losing the reward, you're losing the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He wants to bestow on you. Some of you come to Jumu'ah, some of you women, and it's not obligatory for you to come in the first place, and you're disturbing the women who want to listen to the khutbah, or you disturb the people, the women who want to listen to the classes, so that they may get closer to Allah. I'm taking this time again to remind you women to keep your mouth shut. When you come to these classes, be quiet. If you can't do that, go home. Go home, go home. This place is the house of Allah. It is for the remembrance of Allah. It is not for backbiting. It is not for slander. It is not for namima, tail carrying. It is not for gossiping. If you're not here to learn and make dhikr of Allah, stay home, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his book, وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ. Stay in your homes. It's better for you. It's better for you. So if you women keep coming to the masjid on Jumu'ah or any other time for classes or whatever, when instruction is being given, we're going to ask you to leave. And we have the right to do so because of the sanctity of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.